فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Another type of محتف بالقرائن is a hadith which is mashhoor. The hadith which is mashhoor. إذا كانت له طرق متباينة. حافظ بن حجر mentions it. But with the condition, he says that it has narrations which are different. متباينة means أي مختلفة متغيرة. The hadith is mashhoor and it has different narrations. سالمة من ضعف الرواة والعلل. And these narrations are safe from weakness and defect. Who is the person who mentioned that this type of hadith also is muhtaf bil qara'in? Is al-ustad Abu Mansur al-Baghdadi. And al-ustad Abu Bakr ibn Fawrak wa ghayruhuma. Who is Ustad Abu Mansur al-Baghdadi? He's Abdul Qadir ibn Tahir al-Baghdadi. You can find his tarjama in the Kitab al-Bidayah wal-Nihaya, the 12th volume, page 44. Abu Bakr ibn Fawrakna, he is the famous Ash'ari Imam who died in 406. You can find his biography in Wafayatul A'yan. The third type of hadith which is muhtaf bil qara'in. First was muttafaqa, a hadith which is Bukhari and Muslim. The second was a hadith which is mashhur. Now it is مسلسل بالأئمة الحفاظ. مسلسل بالأئمة الحفاظ المتقنين. It's the hadith which it is chained, okay, with the noble حفاظ hadith. This hadith cannot be strange now. Such as the hadith narrated from Imam Ahmad رحمه الله مثلا, from Imam Shafi'i, from Imam Malik ibn Anas. Are you there? And then Malik narrates from Nafi, and Nafi narrates from Ibn Umar, and then Ibn Umar narrates from the Prophet. This hadith is مسلسل بالحفاظ المتقنين. Ahmad is a Jabal, Shafi'i is a Jabal, Malik is a Najm, star. Nafi and Ibn Umar, Malik and Nafi and Ibn Umar, من أصح الأسانيد. Considered one of the golden chains, right? This chain now, it is called مسلسل بالأئمة الحفاظ. The imams are ranked here, that are written here. They alone, by themselves, are equal to 10 individuals. 10 reliable individuals, Ahmad is. Like sometimes Ahmad ibn Hanbal might oppose 10 people and will give presents to Ahmad over them. Shafi'i might oppose 10 people, 20 people. We'll say Shafi'i is right. It's Jabal, it's a mountain, it's Mutqin. He's from the Hufad al-Mutqinin. Are you there? Because of the characteristics that they gathered. Hifz and Fahm and etc. Are you there? This is called Musalsal bil-A'imma. This is called Al-Musalsal bil-A'imma al-Hufad al-Mutqinin. Those three are what? Those hadith are called what? What's the benefit of learning this right now? Some might say, do I really need to know this part? What's the benefit? What? Remember, what did I say before? If something you're learning does not have a thamara, it doesn't have a fruit that comes out of it, there's no outcome, you're not gonna apply it, just knowing it is of no benefit. صح? When the Usuliyin are talking about whether Mubah is from Ahkam al-Taklifiyya, the question for you as a Talib al-Ilm is what? Is what's the thamara? There's no thamara. No benefit. If I learn that Mubah is from the Ahkam al-Taklifiyya, why is it not? These are called Mulahul Ilm. It's just benefit, side benefits. خلاص. Are you with me? There's no fruitful benefit that you take from it. So what benefit do I take personally from learning the ahadith which are ahad yufidu al-ilm al-nadari al-muhtafu bil-qara'in? What benefit do I get from it? The benefit comes at tarjih inda ta'aruf. When the ahadiths are opposing each other, how do you strengthen one over the other? You will not treat a hadith which are ahad the same as a hadith which are ahad, which is a muhtaf bil qara'in. Does that make sense? This is stronger. You strengthen this over this. So it benefits you when you come to the issue of a tarjih and the ta'aruf, to strengthen views, narration over another narration. Are you with me? When you wanna? Because this one now benefits you, ilm al-nadari. But it doesn't, the benefit here is not amal. It's not benefit in terms of amal, in terms of hadith al-ahad and hadith al-mutawatir, both of them. عند العمل, we do them the same. The people who conflated and between what it benefits you and the implementation are the Mu'tazila. Are you with me? Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe the khabar which is ahad. Are you there? Of course. No one's going to deny that yufidu al-ilm al-dhanni. Yufidu al-dhan. Yufidu al-dhanni. It benefits us, speculation and assumption. Are you there? But the question here is, the question here is what? Just because it does that mean implementation are not done? يُعْمَل يُعْمَل بِهِ, it is implemented. Are you there? And the ahkam of the sharia is not all done based on what? It's not all done with ilm, it's done with dhan. Sahih? Are you with me, brothers? We do sometimes things on Islamic rulings which are not 100%. We do have to still do it. Like the famous hadith of Usama ibn Zayd. The man is in the middle of the battlefield. Usama ibn Zayd is fighting with him. And we all know when you want to give da'wah to somebody in Islam, it takes days, it takes weeks, it takes months, it takes hours, it takes convincing. He just killed a Muslim. Then you're about to strike him. The assumption is high that this person is what? That he's lying. But you still have to hold him account to what he says, right? Are you there? Are you with me, brothers? A Muslim person comes up to you and says to you, I am a Muslim. They travel from the land of the disbelievers. I'm not 100% sure if this person is. I'm not 100% sure if you're a Muslim. You could be a hypocrite, you could be an infiltrator, you could be. I base my ahkam, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا جَاءَكُمُ الْمُؤْمِنَاتُ مُهَاجِرَاتٌ فَامْتَحِنُوهُنَّ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِإِيمَانِهِنَّ فَإِنْ عَلِمْتُمُوهُنَّ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ فَلَا تَرْجِعُوهُنَّ إِلَى الْكُفَّارِ فَإِنْ عَلِمْتُمُوهُنَّ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ. How do I know they're believers? How can I know that they're believers? I don't know if they're believers. I'm basing it on seeing this person praying in the jama'ah and the jum'ah. I'm basing it on seeing this person at night. Sometimes I slept in their house and I saw them crying at night and praying Qiyamul Layl. All of these are just speculation. I can't say 100% I can put my life that this person is a believer. Are you with me? So we do things based on what? Al-dhan. We do even in our day-to-day life. Sah. Everything we do, is it certainty? You know, that's junoon. So the ahkam of the sharia are like that. Okay? We do matters in the religion. So ahadith al-ahad, if somebody says it is yufidu al-dhan, yufidu ilmu al-dhani, we won't say to him, akhi, you're a mu'tazili. That's unjust. We won't say that. But if he talks about the concept of al-amal, in terms of implementation-wise, we'll say what? Now you're talking about the i'tiqad of the mu'tazila. Are you with me? The i'tiqad of the... Now that we've learned that muhtaf bil-qara'in, if a hadith is mushhoor and another one is gharib, which one do you give precedence over? And they're both ahad, right? Why do you give مشهور more presence? Because it's محتف بالقرائن. As long as the مشهور here is what? متباينة الطرق. The طرق is different, right? You strengthen that over that. Both of them, the مشهور and the غريب, both of them are from what? كليهما, both of them are من أخبار الآحاد. But they strengthen one over the other. Also the scholars, they give strength to a hadith which are in Bukhari and Muslim over that which is in Bukhari alone. Or that which is in Muslim alone. And they strengthen what's in Bukhari more than what's in Muslim. Sahih? All of this is... That's how you have to understand. This is the benefit it teaches you. We learn from it عند الترجيح عند التعارض. That's the فائدة of learning this point of المحتف بالقرائن. صحيح؟ The hadith which is مسلسل بالأئمة الحفاظ المتقنين that we have أحمد and we have شافعي and we have مالك and we have ابن نافع and ابن عمر عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. This hadith is given precedence over any other narration. As I said, Ahmed by himself is equal to 10 individuals here. 10 individuals who are reliable and their precision is on point. Ahmed is still stronger than them. Are you with me? Malik, Shafi'i is the same. Malik is the same. Are you there? Malik is Nafi' and Ibn Hakada. Are you there? We give precedence to this narration over anything else. Okay. The author then says, ثُمَّ الْغَرَابَةُ إِمَّا أَن تَكُونَ فِي أَصْلِ السَّنَدِ أَوْ لَا. The author, he speaks about, and he says, وَالثَّانِي الْفَرْدُ النِّسْبِيُّ. Author, rahimahullah, he categorizes the hadith which is غريب. Hafiz ibn Hajar, he now categorizes the hadith which is غريب. Hadith غريب is what? Hadith only one person narrates. Are you with me, brothers? And that's the one type of ahad. How many types of ahad did we say? What's the lowest of them? Gharib. Gharib is the least. He categorized the gharib into two. Gharib, which is called mutlaq, and gharib, which is nisbi. What is the gharib, which is mutlaq? Somebody asks you and says to you, what is gharib mutlaq? A hadith, which is gharib mutlaq. It is التي تكون في أصل السند. It is the hadith which is at the beginning of the chain. What does it mean أصل السند? In other words, عن رسول الله, from the Prophet, the companion who took it from the Prophet is only one who conveyed, who brought it to us from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Are we together? Yeah? No? Now what we don't say, brothers and sisters, is that one companion heard it from the Prophet. We don't say that. There could be more than one companion who heard it from the Prophet. But what we say is that one companion narrated from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. It's important. There's a difference. Okay? So one أَلَّا يُرْوَى مَتْنُ الْحَدِيثِ فِي الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا بِإِسْنَادٍ وَاحِدٍ يَتَفَرَّدُ بِهِ أَحَدُ الرُّوَاتِ وَلَا يُتَابِعُ عَلَيْهِ أَحَدٍ. That's the ta'rif of it. That this hadith on the face of this earth, we will only find it from this one companion. What's he alone on? المتن والسند. He's alone on the salad, the chain, and he's alone on the matn, the wording. Every chain goes back to him, that companion. Are you with me? Every single wording comes back to him. Are you there? He's alone on that wording and he's alone on that chain. We now don't look at the whether that hadith is authentic or whether it's not or no. وأما الغرابة النسبية, as for the غرابة which is نسبي, the غرابة which is نسبي is التي لا تكون في أصل السند. It's the one that's not in the أصل of the chain. It basically happened during the chain based on one individual. He made it strange. He made it one. So the gharib, which is nisbi, al-gharabatu al-nisbiyya, هي التي, it's the thing, the gharib al-nisbiyya, التي لا تكون في أصل السند. It is not at the أصل of the سند. It is not at the أصل of the سند. Due to one particular individual, it becomes strange. For example, it's like a hadith which is narrated from two different phases. One of them Abu Huraira, and the other one is Anas ibn Malik, مثلا. Are you there? The hadith of Anas ibn Malik has only come from one tariq. So it's gharib in regards to who particularly? Anas. As for the hadith of Abu Huraira, فَلَهُ طُرُقٌ كَثِيرًا, has many tariq that come to it. It could even be Abu Huraira as well, it could be mashhur, it could be aziz, it could even be mutawatir, no problem. But we're going to look at the hadith of who? Anas ibn Malik. And what are we going to say? Anas ibn Malik's hadith is what? Anas ibn Malik's hadith is غريب. When we say hadith of Anas ibn Malik is غريب, we don't mean أصل السند. We can't be أصل السند لأن two صحابيز narrated it. Abu Huraira and Anas narrated it. Does that make sense? But what we mean is those who took from him, Anas, are only one person. مثلا, the scholars sometimes would say one person narrates from Al-Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri. And for example, the scholars will say, هذا حديث غريب عن الزهري. This hadith is غريب from Zuhri. In other words, no one else narrated it from Zuhri except Fulan, somebody. So and so is the only one who narrated from it. And the same can happen with a hadith. Are you with me? The scholars, they categorize the hadith which is gharab and nisbiyah, the second type, into three. The first one is tafarrud bi'tibari halir rawi. And that's the one I explained already, which is, it is singular in accordance to one narrator. A teacher as Zuhri and others, they have many students. Only one person narrates a hadith from Zuhri. Are you with me? This is a hadith which is غريب نسبي. No other reliable person narrated from Zuhri except that person, knowing that Zuhri has hundreds of students, or tens of students. That's the first one. An example of this is hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he says, دَقَلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the Prophet entered مَكَّةَ, he entered Mecca, يَوْمَ الْفَتْحِ وَعَلَى رَأْسِهِ مِغْفَرَةٌ. The Prophet, he entered Mecca the day of the conquest and he had on his head the مِغْفَرَةٌ. The مِغْفَرَةٌ is what? Helmet. So the Prophet was wearing a helmet. Who is the only person who narrated from Zuhri? Zuhri has many thiqat students that narrated from him. The only person who we know narrated from him is who? The only person we know who narrated from him is Malik ibn Anas, Imam Malik. No one else narrated from him. Very good. The second one is ما قيد بأهل مصر معينين. This hadith, only people who narrated it is a particular people from a particular land. And the people from that particular land are the only ones who are single in this narration. So whenever it's narrated from them. For example, the scholars will sometimes say, هذا الحديث لم يروه إلا أهل المدينة. This hadith, no one else narrated it except the people of Medina. Or أهل البصرة. Or the people of Basra are the only ones who narrated this. Or أهل الكوفة. Or the people of Kufa. Or أهل مصر. Or the people of Misr. Or أهل مصر. Or the people of Misr. Or for example, scholars sometimes will say, هذه سنة. This is a sunnah. تفرد بها أهل المدينة. The only people who is alone in the sunnah is Ahlul Medina or Ahlul Basra. هكذا. All of this is tafarrud nisbi, but it's all to a particular land. For example, Hadith al-Buruki, the hadith of going down on your knees or your hands. This hadith, Abu Zinad is the one who narrated it. He narrated from Al-A'raj and Abi Huraira. Ali Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet said, إِذَا سَجَدَ أَحَدُكُمْ, if one of you is doing sujood, فَلَا يَبْرُكْ كَمَا يَبْرُكُ الْبَعِيرُ وَلْيَضَعْ يَدَيْهِ قَبْلَ الرُّكْبَتَيْهِ. Are you there? Let him place his hands before his knees. This hadith is a hadith. The scholars, they say it's a sunnatun تَفَرَّدَ بِهَا أَهْلُ الْمَدِينَةِ. أَهْلُ الْمَدِينَةِ are alone on this. No one else is known from this except them. All of the narrators are Madaniyun. Abi Zinad is a Madani. A'raj is a Madani. And Abu Hurairah was a companion. Are you there? Good. الثالث. A hadith, the third type. ما كان مقصورا على رواية معينة. Another one is, it is specific to a particular riwayah. Specific to a particular narration. And we mentioned this at the beginning of our speech, when we were speaking. So go back there, inshallah ta'ala, to it. Last but not least, the author, rahimahullah, said, وَيَقِلُّ طْلَاقُ الْفَرْدِيَّةِ عَلَيْهِ. The author now goes into that little do the scholars refer to the fard nisbi as fard. They don't use it. They don't use fard. Even that the gharib and fard are mutaradifani, they are synonyms, they are close in meaning. They don't do that. وَيَقِلُّ, it is little, إِطْلَاقُ الْفَرْدِيَّةِ, the usage of the term الْفَرْدِيَّةِ, the usage of the term فَرْدِيَّةِ is very little in comparison to the word غريب. Which type of غريب is he talking about that they would use the word فرد for? He's talking about the غريب نسبي. The غريب نسبي, the محدثون, the scholars of hadith, little did they describe the hadith which is غريب نسبي as فرد. In other words, they don't say the hadith which is fard nisbi. The scholars of hadith generally don't say هذا حديث تفرد به الزهري. They don't say that. They say هذا حديث غريب من حديث الزهري. As for when the hadith is غريب مطلق, which is the first time, right? When the hadith, if the hadith is غريب مطلق, فيوصف بالفردية. They would refer it to it as فرد. And they would say هذا حديث فرد. This hadith which is فرد. So all the author here now is talking about is what is known as من حيث الاصطلاح, the usage of this word. And as they say, the قاعدة is لا مشاحة في الاصطلاح. They shouldn't really pull and push on terms. And the author, rahimahullah, he used the word يقل, it is least little. Meaning it does sometimes happen that they do use it. But he said it's very little. So you do sometimes find present in the kalam of Ahlul Ilm, but it's very little, as Hafiz ibn Hajar said. And Hafiz rahimahullah, he is truly said to be Ahlul Istiqra al-Tam, from the ulama who did istiqra of the ahadith and the aqwal of the ulama. And when he says this, he's talking from his experience. He's got ihtirazat, he's got some things he can bring out of there. Are you there? He followed up the statements of the ulama, rahimahullah. So summary is that there's no difference in summary between al-gharib and al-fard. The only thing is, it's used more in the second. Gharib mutlaq, fard is used. But it's not used in the gharib nisbi. It's little, so it is used, but it's very little, very, very little. But when it comes to the gharib mutlaq, and the fard are used, فَيُسْتَعْمَلُ فِيهِمَا عَلَى حَدٍ سَوَاءٍ. They used exactly the same. Two benefits that we take from this, inshallah ta'ala. The first benefit that we take from it is, some of the scholars, people of knowledge, they have coined the term al-gharib as to be a tafarrudi. Some of the scholars of Ahlul Ilm, they unrestrictedly use gharib, the gharib, as any singular narration which it has become clear to them that it's wrong. So some scholars, from people of knowledge, have coined the usage of the word al-gharib as to be the narration which is, it has one narrator, additionally added onto that, that there's a mistake in it. In other words, it's not just one and it's authentic, but it's actually, they use gharib specifically when they want to say that this is only one narrator and it's weak. In other words, they're using it to weaken the narration and to say that the hadith is incorrect. Very good. And an example of that is the Risala to Abi Dawood ila Ahli Makkah. The Risala, the letter that Abu Dawood wrote to describe his Sunan. Abu Dawood, he described his Sunan. A letter was sent to him from the people of Makkah, requesting for him to explain what's in his book, his Sunan, how he authored it, and what is it that he's explaining in this book, and what is he trying to say in this book. So Abu Dawood responded, he wrote a letter. It's called Risalat Abi Dawood ila Ahli Makkah. Are you with me, brothers? Which he's trying to describe his what? His Sunan. So what he says in that is, he says, Abu Dawood says, لا يحتج بحديث غريب ولو كان من رواية مالك ويحيى بن سعيد والثقات من أئمة الحديث ولو احتج رجل بحديث غريب وجدت من يطعن فيه ولا يحتج بالحديث الذي احتج به إذا كان الحديث غريبا شاذا. He says, it is not used as a proof, a hadith which is غريب. What does he mean here? Are you going to say, oh, it's a hadith gharib. If one narrator narrates it, we're not going to take it. And the scholars of hadith differ on, and it's here are the a'imma who say, you can't take one narrator. Are you there? And bid'ah would use these kind of statements. He'd say, la. Gharib here to him is التفرد الذي ترجح عليه أما فيه الخطأ. It is one narrator and it has become clear to Abu Dawood that it's what? There's a mistake in this hadith. So he's saying that if the hadith is gharib, ولو كان من رواية مالك, even if it's from the riwayat of Imam Malik, or the riwayat of Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Qattan, or the riwayat of ثقات من أئمة العلم, the reliable scholars of ilm al-hadith, even if it's from their narration, don't take the hadith which is gharib and don't use it as a proof. Are you with me, brothers? Here, what does he mean by it, gharib? He means التفرد الذي ترجح فيه الخطأ. It doesn't mean لا على كل التفرد. It doesn't mean all of the forms of gharib. Are you there? So here he's trying to use the تفرد or the gharib بقصد إعلان الحديث فيه. He's trying to use this تفرد here or this gharib here, trying to weaken the narration and say this narration shouldn't be taken. Are you there? And that's what's apparent from his statement, rahimahullah ta'ala. Example of that is also Imam Ahmad's statement, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his Kitab al-Kifaya, page 225, it's mentioned. He said, إِذَا سَمِعْتَ أَصْحَابَ الْحَدِيثِ يَقُولُونَ Ahmad said that if you hear the people of hadith saying, هَذَا حَدِيثٌ غَرِيبٌ أَوْ فَائِدَةٌ فَعَلَمْ أَنَّهُ خَطَأٌ He said, no. That if the people of hadith say to you this hadith is gharib, or there's a fa'idah, fa'alam know annahu khata'un, know that this hadith is wrong. Or dakala hadithun fi hadithin, or a hadith has entered into another hadith. Or khata'un min al-muhadithi, or is a mistake from the muhadith. Or hadithun laysa lahu isnadun, or it's a hadith without a chain. Wa in kana qad rawa al-shu'bat wa sufyan. Even al-shu'bat wa sufyan are the ones who narrated it. Are you with me? Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, in his Sharh Ilal al-Tirmidhi, second volume, page 582, he said something very powerful. Okay? As we all know, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, what did he do? Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, he authored the Sharh of Sunan al-Tirmidhi. You know that, right? Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, he explained all of Sunan al-Tirmidhi. But when the Tatar came into the Muslim world, they took the Sunan al-Tirmidhi and many other books and they threw it into the sea. And it got destroyed. And it's from the works that we've lost. We haven't, from the books that we don't have. But we have a portion of the Sunan al-Tirmidhi which he explained, which is the Ilal type, the Ilal chapter of Sunan al-Tirmidhi by Ibn Rajab we have. And in that, the scholars of Hadith, they said, if, I think it's Zainuddin al-Iraqi, I think he said it. He said, if we were to gain and we were to receive the sharah of Tirmidhi by Ibn Rajab, it would have sufficed us for many, many shuruh. We wouldn't need no one's explanation. If we received that and we got that, it would have sufficed us for many explanations. Are you with me, brothers? It would have. Because Ibn Rajab is known for his what? Sard Aqwal al-Salaf, he would bring the statements of the Salaf and put things in context and explain a lot of things. But what we have from it is the what? Ilal al-Tirmidhi type, Ilal al-Tirmidhi section. The Ilal section, his explanation we have, alhamdulillah. It never got lost. And the best tahqiq of it is Nuruddin al-Itr's tahqiq. The tahqiq of Nuruddin al-Itr on the Sharh Ilal al-Tirmidhi by Ibn Rajab is the best. It's the best. Ibn Rajab says, Al-Hanbali, وَأَمَّا أَكْثَرُ الْحُفَّاظِ الْمُتَقَدِّمِينَ فَإِنَّهُمْ يَقُولُونَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ إِذَا انْفَرَدَ بِهِ وَاحِدٌ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَرْوِ الثِّقَاتُ خِلَافَهُ إِنَّهُ لَا يُتَابَعُ عَلَيْهِ وَيَجْعَلُونَ ذَلِكَ عِلَّةً فِيهِ اللهم إلا أن يكون ممن كثر حفظه واشتهرت عدالته وحديثه كالزهري ونحوه، وربما يستنكرون بعض تفردات الثقات الكبار أيضا، ولهم في كل حديث نقد خاص وليس عندهم لذلك ضابط يضبطه. He says, أما أكثر الحفاظ المتقدمين, many of the early حفاظ of hadith, the early generation, فإنهم يقولون, they will say, في الحديث إلى حديث إذا انفرد به واحد, if one person is alone on it, وإن لم يروي الثقات خلافه, even if the reliable scholars haven't narrated anything opposite to it, they will say, إنه لا يتابع عليه, he's not followed in this, ويجعلون ذلك علة فيه, and they would sometimes make this a defect for it. اللهم accept إلا أن يكون ممن كثر حفظه, except somebody whose memorization is what? His memorization is great, and it's a lot. واشتهرت عدالته وحديثه, or his integrity and his ahadith are famous, كالزهري ونحوه, like an Imam Muhammad Shihab Zuhri and anyone other than him. وربما, it even sometimes happens, يستنكرون بعض تفردات الثقات الكبار أيضا. Sometimes it may even happen that they turn down and they reject some of the singular narrations of the reliable ones, the noble reliable ثقات الكبار also. ولهم, and they have, في كل حديث نقد خاص, every hadith they have a specific debunking and refutation on it, وليس عندهم لذلك ضابط يضبطه, and there's no ضابط for it that you can restrict it to. That's how it is. Sometimes you come across Ahmed rahimullah, he weakens the narration, you just don't know why. خلاص ليس له ضابط يضبطه, there's no ضابط which can we can use to restrict it. Another benefit, the second benefit that we take is, the second benefit that we take is, the scholars of hadith, they give a lot of consideration to the hadith which is gharib nisbi. They give it inaya khasa. Specifically, they give it a lot of inaya. The hadith which is gharib nisbi. They give a lot of importance. Why? لأنهم به يحكمون لأنهم به يحكمون على الرواية بالإصابة أو الخطأ أو الإعلان. Because it's this hadith that they place the ruling on the hadith, whether it's right or wrong or defected or not. For example, if you go to Kutub al-Ilal, if you go to it, you sometimes see them say, أخطأ هذا الراوي. This narrator, he done a mistake. When he narrated this hadith from Zuhri, for example, even though this hadith is mahfuz bihadha al-isnad, even though it's correctly transmitted, there's no weakness in it. You hear me, brothers? When you look at this, narrators who narrated each individual from each person, it's connected. This person is not a mudallis. This person is nothing wrong with him. Are you there? Hadith is connected nicely, nothing wrong with it. But they place an illah on it. They say this hadith is defected. And we know defect, right? Illah is a shay which is ghumud. It's not clear to you. They will defect that hadith by saying that this individual, he done a mistake in this hadith narrating it from Zuhri. And this hadith might be mahfuz from other than Zuhri. They would say that. Very good. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll stop there today bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger is free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.